It has been written, with every ending, there is a new beginning. And so it was on a freezing cold, fog-shrouded morning of November 17, 1987. A plane landed in St. John's, Newfoundland. The end of a journey that began 2 days earlier in ancient Olympia, where the Olympic flame was lighted by the rays of the sun. Now, here in Newfoundland, Canada's first landfall, the journey of the flame would begin again. Days through the villages, towns, and cities of Canada. Almost 7,000 torchbearers, chosen by lot from nearly 7 million Canadians who sought the honor, would each carry the flame 1 kilometer on a course designed to retrace Canada's history. The great cities of Montreal, Toronto, and Vancouver, along with historic places like Whitehorse, Yellowknife, and Inuvik. During the journey, the torch would be carried by the descendants of the Inuit and Indian peoples, once the only inhabitants of Canada. For almost 3 months, the torch made its way across the country by day and by night. The bearers of the flame came from every walk of life, the old, the young, the physically challenged, all bound together by the symbol that through history has almost mystically remained a link to all that was, all that is, all that will be. As the torch moves through the Canadian countryside, the athletes of the world arrive in Calgary. And then, on the afternoon of February 13th, the final act of the drama. The more than 18,000 kilometer journey was nearing its end. And with the arrival of the flame, a new beginning. The signal for the 15th Olympic Winter Games in Calgary to begin. More than 60,000 people await the flame. But first, almost 2,000 athletes representing 57 countries pass in review. Young men and women who would compete during the next 2 weeks for the honor of their team and the glory of sport. A tradition that began more than 6 decades earlier in Chamonix, France, the first Olympic Winter Games. Now, 64 years later, Calgary continues the tradition to play host to the young men and women who are the best to come forth from their native lands. One by one, the nations of the world pass in review. And for some of these athletes, there is a dream. A dream that they will become part of Winter Olympic history, to place their names with the legends of the past. Sonia Henny, Tony Seiler, Veiku Hakulinen, Jean-Claude Keeley, Barbara Ann Scott, Eugenio Monti, Eric Heiden, Irina Rodnina. But in this opening day parade, there are athletes who know they are here only for the joy of the competition, to enter the arena and make the attempt. Nation. Their standard bearer, Brian Boucher, who won the silver medal in the figure skating 4 years earlier in Sarajevo.
On behalf of the Calgary Olympic Organizing Committee, I am pleased and honored.
The chairman of the Calgary Olympic Organizing Committee, Frank King.
I now have the honor.
Juan Antonio Samaranch, the President of the International Olympic Committee.
Jean Sauvé, Governor General of Canada, to proclaim the 15th Olympic Winter Games in Calgary open.
Je proclame l'ouverture des Jeux Olympiques de Calgary, célébrant les 15e Jeux Olympiques d'hiver. I declare open the Games of Calgary, celebrating the 15th Olympic Games.
The Olympic flag enters the stadium. Borne by athletes who are part of Canadian Winter Olympic history. Thousands of birds are released, symbolic of the doves of peace. Now the climactic moment is almost at hand. 88 torchbearers, each representing a day in the journey of the flame through Canada, which began almost 3 months ago. The torch arrives, borne by Kathy Priestner, a 1976 speed skating silver medalist, and Ken Reed, a member of the 1976 and 1980 Olympic Alpine teams. Honor is paid to Rick Hansen, who gained international fame by traveling under his own power around the world to raise millions for spinal cord research. Now the final torchbearer, 12-year-old Robin Perry of Calgary, a seventh grade schoolgirl. Thank you. This is Gaetan Boucher, his wife Corinne, and their two children. They live close to Montreal, Quebec. Gaetan Boucher is Canada's greatest Olympic champion, a speed skater who competed in four Olympic Games, the winner of two gold, one silver, and one bronze medal. Gaetan Boucher is a living legend, not only for his victories, but evermore for his personification of the Olympic philosophy. Ask not alone for victory, ask for courage. For if you can endure, you bring honor to yourself. Even more, you bring honor to us all. It is 3 p.m. Saturday, February 20th, 1988. The Olympic Oval, Calgary. The arena is almost empty. In less than 2 hours, the stadium will be filled to capacity with almost 4,000 people. They and many millions throughout the world will witness the 1500-meter championship, the final race in the memorable career of 29-year-old Gaetan Boucher. Boucher arrives early.
Yeah, I do that for every race. You're trying to do the race mentally and, trying to relax a little bit. You know, it's mainly to not to get too nervous and try not to be too tense and, forget about everything else. I was very nervous for the 1500.
Gaetan Boucher's appearance here in Calgary is a minor miracle. A year before the 1984 Sarajevo Games, Boucher broke his left ankle. Amazingly, he recovered and went on to win two gold and one bronze medal in Sarajevo. A year after his victories in 1984, his ankle injury returned.
It started deteriorating. It was hard to answer these questions, how is your ankle? Mainly because people didn't really seem to believe, well, how come you skated so well in 84? You don't have a problem. You're just lost your confidence and that's it. Forget about your ankle. And I had people say that, maybe when you stop thinking about your ankle, it will be better.
It was very hard because he was often very depressed and he tried very hard to do better and it just wouldn't work. I would keep on telling him, if you have a problem, you have to skate with your ankle. That's all you can do.
Gaetan's parents, Louise and Cyrenis Boucher, arrive for the 1500-meter Calgary final, hours before the race is to begin.
Right after Sarajevo, Gaetan was thinking if he should keep going or to stop. Many people were saying, well, you should stop now that you won gold medals. And Louise, my wife, was hoping that he would stop also. Well, when Gaetan wants something, he sticks to it. And there's something we say in French, in tête de cochon, I believe it's stubborn. He always was like that, since he is a boy.
At age 17, Gaetan Boucher competed in the 1976 Innsbruck Games, but did not win a medal. 4 years later in Lake Placid, the luck of the draw placed him in the 1,000-meter race with Eric Heiden of the United States.
He was, I guess, for everybody, the guy to beat. He was a hero. And I might have said, well, forget it, I'm not going to be able. So instead, I just thought, well, I'll do as best as I can. And if he has a bad race and I have a very good race, then maybe I'll win. But when he crossed the finish line, I thought I was so far behind, and I didn't think I was fast enough for a medal. But the time was fast enough, and I guess he was just so far ahead of everybody.
Eric Heiden defeats Boucher by 1.5 seconds, but Boucher's time is still fast enough to win the silver medal in the competition. Eric Heiden goes on to win a total of 5 gold medals. February 8, 1984, the opening day ceremonies of the Sarajevo Olympic Games. 25-year-old Gaetan Boucher is given the honor of carrying the Canadian flag.
What I remember the most was that people were saying, the last two Olympics, the person who carried the flag didn't do very well. We hope that you're going to break this bad luck. I didn't really care so much because I had so much confidence in 84 that it's not bad luck to carry the flag. It doesn't mean you have to skate bad.
In the 500 meters, Gaetan Boucher finishes third to win the bronze medal. A few days later, the final of the 1,000 meters. Gaetan Boucher wins the competition by almost a full second, his first Olympic gold medal. He immediately calls his parents.
He called and he was so happy. And I said, well, finally, I got your medal. Because I keep asking Gaetan, you must win a gold medal. And the first gold medal you win, it's my medal.
A few days later, he wins the 1500 meters and makes Canadian Winter Olympic history. The only Canadian to win two gold medals and the only Canadian to win four Olympic medals.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen.
It is now 5 p.m., February 20th, 1988, 1 hour before Gaetan Boucher will skate the last race of his career. He is defending Olympic champion in this, the 1500 meter race. 40 of the greatest skaters in the world are entered. 20 races, two skaters facing one another in each race. The course is 400 meters. It is the first time in Olympic history that speed skating will be contested indoors. The competition begins. The start is staggered. In order to equalize the distance, there are inside and outside lanes. The skaters must switch lanes each lap at a specified crossover point. At the end of the 20 races, the skaters with the three fastest times will stand on the victory platform to receive the gold, silver, and bronze medals. Gaetan Boucher will skate in the 15th out of 20 races. This fact has particular significance. Most of the men he will have to beat for a medal will be competing in the first six races. And he will know in advance the time he has to beat.
The 1500, I had told everybody, well, you know, it would be my best race. With the good technique that I have, I could be able to win. I don't really dream about things that, you know, that I don't think I could reach.
In the very first race, there is a strong indication of what Gaetan Boucher must do when he finally steps to the starting line. Eric Flame of the United States creates a world record. The world record lasts less than 8 minutes. In the third race, Andre Huffman of East Germany is 0.06 of a second faster than Eric Flame. Huffman of East Germany is in first place. Eric Flame of the United States, second. The fourth pairs are now on the ice. They will travel 3¾ times around the 400 meter course. At the finish, Michael Hatschief of Austria is superb, the third fastest time of the evening, and better than the original world record. Igor Zhilozhovsky of the Soviet Union is in the sixth pair. He has already seen his world record broken three times. He is just a few hundredths of a second off his original world record. But on this night, it is not good enough to win one of the medals. One by one, the races continue, yet no one can match the performances of Huffman, Flame, and Hatschief. At this moment, they lead for the gold, silver, and bronze medals. Now it is time for the 15th pair. The time for Gaetan Boucher. His partner, Behudin Merdovic of Yugoslavia.
Well, I knew that what it took to win, and I went after the winning time, of course. I was in some mixture of confidence that because I skated very well at the World Cup in December, that I could do well in 1500, but at the same time afraid because I felt tired, you know, before the race.
Gaetan Boucher's parents are seated near the finish line. The scoreboard clock is directly opposite them. A false start. Boucher is the fastest at the first turn.
Good for him!
After 300 meters, Gaetan Boucher is in first place. Is still in first place after 700 meters. With less than 150 meters to go, Boucher is exhausted. He is falling behind the leaders. Coming down the home stretch, Gaetan Boucher knows his quest for a medal is over. Boucher's time is more than 2.5 seconds behind that of Andre Hoffman of East Germany. Gaetan Boucher finishes ninth in the last race of his career. It is at this moment that Gaetan Boucher knows that age and injury have taken their toll.
You pay at the end, you pay for the effort to go that fast. You know, that's it. I'm not going to be able to finish with a good time. I tried, but then physically there was no energy left.
Slowly, he takes one more lap. His final farewell to Olympic competition. Gaetan Boucher does not want to leave the arena on this, the last race of his Olympic career. Soon, the victory platform ceremony will take place.
It took me a long time to leave the rink. I was thinking, well, this is it, you know, so I won't have that feeling anymore of competing for a World Championship or Olympic Games. And, you know, I just couldn't stand up and leave. And what made me leave, actually, was when they said that they would give the medals. And I didn't want to be there. I thought, you know, it'd be too hard if I stayed there and I see the flags go up in the national anthem. So I left and, went back to the dressing room.